Penguin Audio presents Elizabeth I by Margaret George, read by Kate Redding. Elizabeth I by Margaret George. For Robert, my son-in-law, a loyal subject of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, past and present. Archbishop Cranmer. In her days, every man shall eat in safety under his own vine what he plants, and sing the merry songs of peace to all his neighbours. God shall be truly known, and those about her from her shall read the perfect ways of honour, and by those claim their greatness, not by blood. She shall be to the happiness of England an aged princess. Many days shall see her, and yet no day without a deed to crown it. Would I had known no more. But she must die. She must. The saints must have her. Yet a virgin, a most unspotted lily, shall she pass to the ground, and all the world shall mourn her. King Henry VIII. O Lord Archbishop, thou hast made me now a man. Never before this happy child did I get anything. This oracle of comfort has so pleased me that when I am in heaven I shall desire to see what this child does and praise my Maker. William Shakespeare, Henry VIII, Act 5, Scene 4, lines 33-38, 56-68. Elizabeth I. 1. The Vatican, March 1588. Felice Peretti, otherwise known as Pope Sixtus V, stood swaying before the stack of rolled bulls. They were neatly arranged like a cord of wood, alternating short and long sides, their lead seals hanging down like a row of puppy tails. "Ah," he said, eyeing them with great satisfaction. They seemed to radiate power, but one thing was lacking, his blessing. Raising his right hand, he spoke in sonorous Latin, "O sovereign God, hear the prayer of your servant Sixtus, acting in accordance with my office as the vicar of Christ, his representative on earth, who has the power to bind and loose, to forgive sins or withhold forgiveness. I have pronounced judgment on that wicked woman of England, the Pretender Queen. She is hereby excommunicated from the body of Christendom until such time as she repents, in order that those living under her rule do not go down into damnation with her. We bless the enterprise of England. Aboard the ships of the Great Armada, we'll go these bulls of excommunication and sentence upon Elizabeth, the Pretender Queen of England, calling for her deposition, in order that her subjects may be rescued from her impiety and perverse government. They will see the happy light of day when Christ's avengers set boots upon English soil. There they will be distributed to the faithful. Merciful God, we ask this in the Saviour's name and for his holy church." The 68-year-old Pope then slowly circled the pile, making the sign of the cross and sprinkling it with holy water. Then he nodded to the Spanish envoy standing quietly to one side. "You may transport them now," he said. "The Armada leaves from Lisbon, does it not?" "Yes, Your Holiness, next month." Sixtus nodded. "They should arrive in plenty of time, then. You have waterproof canisters for them?" "I am sure they will be provided. King Philip thinks of everything." 2. The South Coast, England, April 1588. The old hermit shuffled out of his shelter as he did every morning. He made his bed in the ruins of St. Michael's Chapel, perched near the peak of a jutting piece of headland stretching out into Plymouth Sound. He stood on the rim of the cliff, the ocean far below him, his eyes darting left and right, searching. The morning sun glinting off the water made it hard to see. He shaded his eyes and squinted, trying to detect the telltale shape of sails on the horizon. Nothing. Not today. Muttering, he turned to attend to his other business, preparing the beacon. He had found an abandoned dolmen, an ancient monument at the pinnacle of the peak, and had been carrying twigs, straw, and kindling there for days. The fire that would flare out from the cone-shaped, mounted brackets must be visible for miles until the next beacon. And this was likely the first. This would be the place, if any place, that the armada would first come into view. And he, the Hermit of St. Michael's, would keep vigilant watch as long as there was a whisper of light to see by. He patted the dolmen. Pagan stuff. Made long ago by vanished people. But who cared if it helped in the fight against the Spanish enemy? 3. The Tower of London, May 1588. Quiet. Philip Howard motioned to the priest. Someone was coming. The guard was making his rounds. His footstep on the stones outside was a sound that Philip heard even in his dreams. He bent his head down, resting it between his knees, his hands hanging limply. He must look asleep. The priest did likewise, drawing his cloak up around himself. The others in the room fell silent, turned to stone. The footsteps paused. The shutter over the iron grill in the prisoner's door lifted. Then it clanged down again and the footsteps continued. Philip stayed still for another few minutes to be safe. Finally he whispered, "He's gone. He won't make rounds again for 2 or 3 hours. Let's begin. Let's begin God's work." The others in the chamber stirred. The priest threw back the covering on his head. "In the name of the Holy Mother Church," he said, "I will perform this mass." Philip shook his head. "It must be dedicated to another intention," he said. "I was not a traitor until they sought to make me one. Now held for 5 years here in the tower, I have seen the evil of the Queen and her so-called church firsthand. It must perish. She must perish. And my godfather, King Philip, will ensure that." In the dim light, the priest's eyes glittered. "And who will the mass be dedicated to?" he asked. "To the success of the armada," said Philip. "May it wreak revenge on this godless nation." "To the success of the armada," the others intoned. The priest began laying out his holy implements, an earthenware cup for a chalice, a wooden saucer for a paten, a rough scarf for a stole. "Let us pray," he began. "O Most High, you have looked down in sorrow upon the blasphemy and sacrilege here in England, once your obedient servant, now a renegade. As of old, when a nation went whoring after false gods, you used a rod to chastise them. You now send your son, King Philip of Spain, a devotee of the true faith, to smite them. Just as there was no mercy for the Amorites or the Philistines or the Canaanites, there can be no mercy for these straying people. If we perish alongside them, we are willing. Look what your servant Philip, Earl of Arundel, has carved here on the wall of his miserable prison. See his fine words. Quanto plus afflictionis pro Christo in hoc saeculo, tanto plus gloriae cum Christo in futuro. The more affliction we endure for Christ in this world, the more glory we shall obtain with Christ in the next. We know, O Lord, that is true." "True, true, true," murmured Philip and his companion prisoners. "O Armada, come quickly to deliver England. Bless all her exiled sons who are aboard, taking up arms to deliver their homeland." Their heated cries echoed within the dank stone chamber. 4. Elizabeth, May 1588. The whip cracked and snapped as it sought its victim. I could see the groom cowering in the bushes, then crawling away in the underbrush as the whip ripped leaves off a branch just over his head. A stream of Spanish followed him, words to the effect that he was a worthless wretch. Then the face of the persecutor turned toward me, shining with his effort. "Your Majesty," he said, "why do you keep my whip?" It was a face I had thought never to see again, that of Don Bernardino de Mendoza, the Spanish ambassador I had evicted from England 4 years earlier for spying. Now he rounded on me and began fingering his whip as he walked toward me. I sat up in bed. I could still smell the leather of the whip, lingering in the air where it had cracked, and that smirk on the face of Mendoza. His teeth bared like yellow carved ivory, I shuddered at its cold rictus. It was only a dream. I shook my head to clear it. The Spanish were much on my mind, that was all. But didn't Mendoza actually leave me a whip? Or did we just find one in his rooms after he hurriedly left? I had it somewhere. It was smaller than the one in the dream, useful only for urging horses, not punishing horse grooms. It had been black and braided, and supple as a cat's tail. Spain's leather was renowned for its softness and strength. Perhaps that was why I had kept it. It was not light out yet. Too early to arise. I would keep my own counsel here in bed. Doubtless devout Catholics, secretly here in England, openly in Europe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.